بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الواحد المنعم والصلاة والسلام على محمد سيد الأنام وعلى آله الكرام وصحبه العظام وسلم تسليما كثيرا ما دام يجري هذا النظام وبعد قال تبارك وتعالى وأن المساجد لله فلا تدعوا مع الله أحدا وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أحب البلاد إلى الله تعالى مساجدها وأبغض البلاد إلى الله أسواقها أو كما قال عليه الصلوات والتسليمات. Respected brothers, elders, mothers, sisters and youngsters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator, our sustainer, the only entity entitled to worship, and we send the choicest blessings upon the final messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings upon him. Everything in this world, when compared with something else, has either a virtue over the other matter or the other thing, or it is less significant. Similarly, when we look at time and when we look at place, it's either time that is more virtuous than the other period, or a place that is more superior or more virtuous than another. So we are in the blessed season of Ramadan. When compared to any other month, the time and the season, the period of Ramadan is far more blessed in comparison to any other month or any other period during the year. Similarly, when we look at space and we look at location or place, there are certain places that are more significant than other places. And one of those places is definitely the masajid, the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the places of worship. I have quoted before you a beautiful hadith of the Prophet peace and blessings upon him, wherein the Prophet peace and blessings upon him describes and he says, أَحَبُّ الْبِلَادِ إِلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى مَسَاجِدُهَا. The most beloved land on the face of this earth are the masajid. وَأَبْغَضُ الْبِلَادِ. And the most detested place on the face of this earth is the marketplaces. And the ulama, the scholars, they explain, the masjid is the place where we connect with the Lord. And many a times, the marketplaces are the places where we forget about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Almighty. So I want to share a few reminders in relation to the masjid, in relation to the places of worship, the buyutullah, the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First of all, we need to understand that there is tremendous importance in regards to the masajid. And we can learn this and we can understand this from one simple action of the Prophet peace and blessings upon him. When he migrated from Mecca to Medina, the first place that he came to was the place of Quba. Banu Amr and the different tribes that embraced him and welcomed him, it was the place of Quba on the outskirts of the city of Medina. And the very first concern that the Prophet peace and blessings upon him had was, we need a place of worship and we need a masjid. And that's when he established the very first masjid of Islam, and that is the Masjid Quba. And then the Prophet peace and blessings upon him, after a few days, he went to the location where we see Masjid al-Nabawi, the Prophet's masjid that stands currently right now. That is the first concern again he had. When he went there, he established the masjid, he built the masjid, he made an effort. According to the historians, the Prophet peace and blessings upon him had purchased a land with his own money for the masjid, Masjid al-Nabawi. And he purchased it from two orphans, Sahal and Suhail radiallahu anhuma. And they had offered the Prophet peace and blessings upon him. They said, O Prophet of Allah, this is our land and you find it a suitable place for the masjid. We offer it to you without any fee, without any money. And the Prophet peace and blessings upon him, he declined. He said, you must take the money. And he gave from his personal funds and he purchased the land from the orphans. And that is the location where the masjid was built. According to the ulama and the historians who write the seerah and the biography of the Prophet peace and blessings upon him, it took approximately 6 months to build the masjid of the Prophet peace and blessings upon him. The Sahaba, the companions, they participated. And the Prophet peace and blessings upon him, after a period of 6 months, he made that the center and the focal point for the believers. Even in travel, when the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, would go on a journey, he would go in safar, he would go in travel with the companions. And if there was any point in time where he would be required to stay for a number of days, then he would look around where they would camp and he would say, I am designated this specific space for the masjid. So a temporary masjid would be democrated and it would be placed there. And as long as they were there, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, and the companions, radiallahu anhum, may Allah be pleased with them, they would perform their prayers and they would gather there for their religious activities in that temporary masjid. So this in itself shows the importance of the masjid and the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him's concern in regards to the masjid itself. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, during his reign, we know according to the history that during his time, the lands expanded tremendously and they all came and fell under the hands, in the hands of the Muslims and the believers. And Umar radiallahu anhu, being the Khalifa, being the Caliph, being the leader, being the head of state, he went out of his way to write a letter to every single governor that he had appointed in every region of the state. And in those instructions, he mentioned, it is very important that in every locality of your responsibility, you establish a masjid where people can come, perform their prayers, and in particularly the Friday prayers, they can assemble and they can make it the focal point of their communities and their societies. So we understand from here as well the importance, the ahmiyyah, the necessity, as well as the importance of the masjid. Now what are some of our duties connected to the masjid? Number one is we need to build masjids and we need to maintain the masajid. We need to build the masajid and we need to maintain them. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, on the topic of building masajid, he said, "Man bana masjidan, bana Allahu lahu baytan fil jannah." Anyone who builds a masjid, who participates in building a masjid, in establishing a masjid, a place of worship, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will build for them a palace in paradise. So it's one of the easy methods to enter paradise. An unknown person at the time of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, according to the narration of Sahih Muslim, this person was a simple person, this person was not so popular in the community, not very well known by people, but this individual would come constantly in the masjid and help in the masjid. Do the cleaning, take care of some of the work voluntarily, and would meet the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, and leave. And this was a general custom. And we know the chambers of the Prophet ﷺ, the rooms, the apartments of the Prophet ﷺ, they were adjacent. They were right next to the masjid. So the Prophet ﷺ often would see people at odd times in the masjid. And one of these persons that he would see was this unknown individual. According to the reports, the name is not even mentioned about who this person was. And that's why the scholars, they debate, was it a male? Was it a female? Was it someone who accepted Islam and was born in Islam? Or later on embraced Islam at a different stage? So all of these questions are asked. This shows that there was so much ambiguity as to who this person was. Nevertheless, this person had passed away, and the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, was informed later on, because he was resting, and it was at a time where the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, was not awake. So they made the arrangements of the funeral and the burial, etc. Later on, the Prophet ﷺ noticed the fuqdan. He missed this individual. That where is this individual that would come and volunteer and help out in the masjid? I haven't seen this individual for a number of days. So they said, قَدْ مَاتْ. This person had passed away. And passed away, we made the arrangements. We didn't want to inconvenience you because you were sleeping. So we decided to complete all the funeral rites. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, he congratulated the companions. You did the right thing, because we're not supposed to delay a funeral. Unnecessary delay of a funeral is not the instruction of Islam. As soon as possible, bury the dead. make the arrangements. That is the instruction from the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. But then he said, this was an important person of my community. Dullani ala qabri. Show me where you have buried this individual. And the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, went with a gathering of the companions. He stood at the graveside and he made supplications and prayers. And according to one report, he offered the Salatul Janazah again. He repeated the funeral prayer again of this individual. And the reason for this, as mentioned by the scholars who give explanation about this narration, is that this person was involved in maintaining the masjid, in contributing toward the masjid, and keeping the masjid alive in an appropriate way. In one of the narrations, it's mentioned, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُنَادِي يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. On the day of judgment, Allah will make an announcement. Allah will make a declaration. And the angels, when they hear this declaration, they will be surprised. What is this announcement? What is this declaration? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, أَيْنَ جِيرَانِي. Where are my neighbors? Where are my neighbors? The angels will say, who could possibly be your neighbor? You have no geographical space that you are limited to. A neighbor is only a person who shares a geographical space. I live in a place and right next to it, whoever lives there is my neighbor. We're sitting here, the person next to us is our neighbor in this majlis, in this gathering. So they said, the angels, they will say on the day of judgment that how can someone or some created being be considered your neighbor? Who are these people? Who are these creations? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself will say, Ummarul Masajid. Those people who constantly come to the masjid, they are my neighbors. Those people who constantly come to the masjid, they are my neighbors. So in the month of Ramadan, mashallah, we see many of you constantly coming to the masjid. May Allah make us all amongst his neighbors. May Allah bless us on the Day of Judgment with this high status, being honored as a neighbor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we invite guests in our home, we are the hosts. The guest is afforded and accorded with a lot of respect. We go out of our ways. It's not the regular meal. We make a special meal for the guest. It's not the regular comfort. We go out of our way to provide immense comfort to the guest. So we make arrangements, we show importance, we do the ikram, we do the respect and the honoring. So according to one narration, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, on the authority of Salman radiallahu anhu, makes a mention that the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, says, anyone who makes wudu, anyone who performs ablution at home, makes wudu at home, or wherever they are coming from, they make wudu, and they prepare to go towards the masjid, كَانَ زَائِرًا لِلَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. They are a visitor. They are a guest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So who is the host? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who is the guest? You and I. So Allah is the host. It's his duty. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, it is his haq. It is the duty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the obligation of Allah that he hosts us with the best of arrangements, the best of rewards, and the best of blessings. So we are guests of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we come to the masajid. And this is one of our responsibilities, that we establish the masjid and we also maintain the masjid with our activities, with our presence, and we go out of our way to honor and respect. And this is one of the responsibilities as well, to always love the masajid. Whenever we see any masjid, then we should make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is your house, O Allah, your mercy descends. We want from this mercy. What's the dua when we enter the masjid? We say, Allahumma iftah li abwaab rahmatik. O Allah, open the gates of your mercy for me. And what is the reason for this? According to one narration, the mercy of Allah descends on the Kaaba. And from the Kaaba, it is distributed to every masjid that is on the face of this earth. So when we enter the masjid, we are seeking that mercy and that blessing that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to love the masajid, we have to honor and respect the masajid. There are signs for everything. If a person wears a certain type of uniform, then we know, oh, this is a police officer, or this is a person who works in such and such a corporation, or has employment, or has a certain position. You have a name tag, you have certain uniform, you have certain machinery or tools. You can understand from these indications and these symbols that this person has association with this specific field. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, the sign of a true believer is that they will constantly go to the masjid. This is their symbol, this is their hallmark. The Prophet ﷺ says, bear testimony of iman, bear testimony of faith. For who? For the person who constantly visits the masjid. Who will go to the masjid? The one who has iman, the one who has faith, the one who loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ذَلِكَ وَمَنْ يُعَظِّمْ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ Allah mentions in the Qur'an there are hallmarks, there are symbols of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the face of this earth. And those hallmarks include the masjid as well. It's one of the reminders that remind us about our Creator and our Lord. In one narration, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, every believer has space in their heart for the masjid. الْمَسْجِدُ بَيْتُ كُلِّ تَقِي Every true dedicated believer has space in their heart. We only put things in our heart that is beloved to us. So a believer finds the masjid also a beloved place. There are many rewards in relation to the masjid and attending the masjid and maintaining the masjid. In one report, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, I was presented, عُرِضَتْ عَلَيَّ I was presented, أَعْمَالُ أُمَّتِي The actions of my community. And I was shown the rewards of all of these. And the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said that there was also a reward for a person who removes even a speck, one speck of dust, qadat, one speck of dust or particle of dust that a person removes from the masjid to keep it clean. It's also part of the great rewards that Allah will bless this individual who has engaged in doing that. Right, so cleanliness is part of the masjid etiquettes. Especially now when it's Ramadan or it's a Jummah, etc. We're sharing the space with other believers. So we have to be considerate. Once the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, Anas radiallahu anhu, was approached and he gave reference to an incident at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What was the question that was asked to Anas radiallahu anhu? He said, what is your opinion about the garlic and about the onion? So the person was asking, is it permissible to consume? Is it not permissible? Is it makruh? Is it disliked? So he said, no, there is protocol. They are permissible, but there is protocol. And he said, I give reference to the time of the Prophet ﷺ when we were with him. Someone had consumed and eaten a raw garlic and came to the masjid. And the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, sensed the odor of the garlic. So he gathered the companions and he said, look, when you come to the masjid, you have to be clean. You have to be odorless. You have to be in a pleasant situation. Why? Because you're sharing the space with two creations. Number one is when you're in the masjid, you're sharing the space with other believers, side by side. And there are also angels that are assembled with us when we assemble in the masjid. And whatever inconveniences humans, it also inconveniences the angels. And that's when the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, whoever has eaten from these two vegetables, from these two items, then they should not attend to the masjid until they clean themselves. So this is a powerful message. When we come to the masjid, we should wash ourselves. You know, the other day a brother said, you know what, in Taraweeh, you know, as we raise our hands, there's the odor of perspiration. Person is sweating. So it's causing inconvenience to the person that is beside us. So make sure we clean ourselves. Make sure we apply itar and perfume. Make sure that we're not causing inconvenience by speaking loudly, by disturbing others. Once the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, was in his room. He was in his apartment. Again, it was adjacent to the masjid. And one sahabi came and he was reciting Quran very loudly. He wasn't talking about business. He wasn't talking about politics. He wasn't talking about his business and trade. What was he doing? He was reciting the Qur'an loudly in the masjid. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, opened the curtain and he addressed the companion. He said, look, there are other people in the masjid with you, so your tone and your voice should be moderate that you don't cause inconvenience to the person who's trying to concentrate in the prayer. So if we talk about other matters such as politics, business and trade, that's a whole different subject as well. Here, we're talking about a good deed, reciting the Qur'an. Yet, while doing a good deed, we need to be cognizant that there are other people with us. So part of the etiquettes of the masjid is that we stay clean. When the Prophet ﷺ spoke about the day of Jum'ah, he also mentioned that we should take a bath on the day of Jum'ah. One of the reasons for this, the historians, the ulama, they write, is that the Sahaba, they were coming from their fields, from their crops. And they would come and attend in the middle of the day, and it would be a large gathering. Why? Because the smaller masajid, they wouldn't have the Jum'ah prayer. They would all come to join in the Jum'ah prayer with the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. So it was a huge gathering, it was a large gathering. So that's why the Prophet ﷺ said, when you come, you're sharing the space, so don't inconvenience anyone. Take a bath, clean yourselves, apply perfume. And it's all part of the sunnah and the etiquettes of the day of Jummah that many of us are all aware of. This is just a reminder that during the month of Ramadan, we populate the masajid, we come in large numbers, so we have to adhere to all the etiquettes and all the protocol. Let me mention one incident during the time of Umar radiallahu anhu. Umar radiallahu anhu is in the masjid, and he notices that two individuals, they're speaking very loudly in the masjid. So he looks at them, but he doesn't recognize them, who these people are. So he told one of the companions that was near him, he said, go call those two individuals here. Both of them came, and he said, where are you from? So they said, we're from Taif. So he said, if you were not from Taif, if you were part of the residents of Medina, I would have reprimanded both of you very severely. Why? Because the people of Medina, they know the etiquettes and the protocol of the masjid, that we don't disturb anyone, we worship in a peaceful way, and we don't cause any inconvenience. But it seems that you are foreigners, you come from a distant place, you may not be educated, so I'm letting you know that these are the protocols of the masjid. A man came in the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ, he was a Bedouin, he didn't have no knowledge, he was in jahiliyyah, he was in ignorance, he came and he urinated in the masjid. And the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, called him, he sat him down and he said, look, these masajid are for the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, remembrance of Allah. Therefore, the recital of the Qur'an. Therefore, salah, etc. This is not a place where we cause purities to be destroyed and now it becomes impure. And he told the Sahaba, look, this person is uneducated, doesn't know. So we have educated him now, so let's clean this up. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum brought buckets of water and they cleaned the area up. And the Prophet ﷺ said, this is the way we keep the masjid clean. Once the Prophet ﷺ came and he saw some phlegm. Someone had some phlegm and they just spit it. It was either on the wall or on the ground, according to the reports. So the Prophet ﷺ, he saw this and he took a stone and he rubbed it till it was gone, either on the wall or on the ground. And there was no carpet at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, it was just sand. So again, these are some indications that I'm pointing out how we have to be mindful. Sometimes, you know, just out of ignorance or just out of habit, we don't understand the protocol of the masjid or we forget about it. And this causes inconvenience to others. Now look, this is a time where many families come. Children also come. So there will be noise, there will be some commotion, there will be children playing around. But sometimes a person gets so mad, they become so angry, you know, don't you have any place to take your children? There's no babysitting, this, that. And a person gets so angry, etc. And the person feels offended. Wallahi, I got an email just the other day. A sister said, I don't want to come to the foundation anymore. So, and then she's explaining why. She said, I brought my children. I'm in the area where the children are supposed to be, the mothers and the children. Yet, there are some sisters who are screaming and yelling and saying, what a shame. Why don't you control your children, etc.? Children, sometimes we can't control them. They're in their designated space. They're obviously going to make some form of inconvenience. The Prophet ﷺ, he saw this man urinating. And the Prophet ﷺ didn't raise his voice. The Prophet ﷺ didn't reprimand him. The Prophet ﷺ understood that he was ignorant. He called him. He sat him down. He explained to him the protocol in a very gentle way that Arabi, that companion, says that I've never seen a teacher like the Prophet ﷺ. So we have to work together because this is a shared space. There is tremendous ahmiyah and importance of the masjid. We have to educate ourselves about the etiquettes and the protocol. This is not a marketplace. This is not our personal homes. We have to honor it and respect it and keep it clean and maintain respect for everyone as we share this space. And we will see ourselves benefiting from that true mercy. Imagine a person comes to the masjid for mercy. There's tremendous blessings and mercy. But if we cause inconvenience to someone, if we block someone in the parking lot, if we let our phones ring so loudly that it disturbs someone who's praying next to us, are we taking the blessings or are we taking the wrath and the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The Prophet ﷺ said, it's better to destroy the structure of the Kaaba than to hurt someone in their heart. Right? So we want to be cognizant about this. This is just a reminder. The masjids are a beautiful place. We want everyone to attend and we want everyone to come, the young and the old. But we have to share the space and respect one another and be cognizant of these etiquettes and these morals that have been taught to us. And by doing so, definitely we will all take the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with us. I conclude with one statement. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, he said, he received verses of the Qur'an wherein Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya Bani Adam, khudhu zinatakum inda kulli masjid. O children of Adam, every time you go to the masjid, take your beauty with you. Zinatakum. Now what's the tafsir of this? The commentators of the Qur'an explain that what it refers to is take your beautiful character with you and your beautiful apparel and your beautiful fragrances and your comfort with you. So that way you are pleasant before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and also pleasant to the people who are also in the masjid with you. And there are sahabi like such as Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. Every time he would go to the masjid, he would change his clothes. You know, when we go to work or when we go to an interview or when we go to meet someone important, we have certain apparel, we have certain nice clothing that we take. So Ibn Umar had these nice pairs of clothing specifically every time he would go to the masjid. Abdullah ibn Umar. And someone once asked him. So he said, I am following the command of Allah where Allah said, Ya Bani Adam, khudhu zinatakum inda kulli masjid. That every time you go to the masjid, take your beauty with you. So this is the reason. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us beautiful people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to value all these blessings of the month of Ramadan. And as we gather and we congregate for the different prayers and the qiyam and the taraweeh, etc. in the month of Ramadan, may Allah allow us to bring all our character and our morals with us. May Allah allow us to maintain the masjid and establish the masjid. May Allah allow us to populate the masajid. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the rewards of this world as well as the hereafter. Wa akhiru da'wana. Alhamdulillah.